Good evening, I'm James Goodale and you're watching The Digital Age. Can mainstream media survive the bloggers? The bloggers have had great victories this year. Rathergate, Easengate, you name them. The bloggers are the new power, the new boys on the media block. How powerful are they? Can mainstream media, that's the New York Times and everything else, survive them? Tonight we're going to find out with Alex Jones, who is the director of the Shorenstein Center at Harvard. Thank you for coming by, Alex.
Good to see you, Jim.
And Tom Lipscomb, who writes for the Chicago Sun Times. Let me start with you.
Sure.
Because you're almost a blogger. You're on the net all the time. Your column is accessible by bloggers. Who are these bloggers, anyway? I mean, everyone wants to know who a blogger is. I'm never able to say who.
It's a great question, and there's actually a technocrat statistic on that. They observe the number of blogs. There are 23,000 new blogs every day.
23,000?
The average blogger is an 18-year-old girl who updates her blog maybe twice a month with her prom dress or whatever else goes on. So the notion of blogging that we in the media are all excited about has nothing to do with the real world of blogging. 23,000.
Well, listen, that makes it worse. I just don't understand, if there are 23,000 a day, how anybody finds what they're thinking. How do they get enough energy to dethrone, if you want to call it that way, Dan Rather?
Well, the interesting point there is, how do we get brand identification in a cacophony like the internet with millions and millions of locations?
Yeah, that's the question.
It took years for CBS to get, New York Times and other media to create theirs, but all of a sudden, anyone in the business can tell you 10 bloggers they never don't read that day.
All right, can you? I don't know if this embarrasses you.
Do I read 10 bloggers a day? No.
Do you read one?
Sometimes I read one. But I mean, I follow blogging in a kind of, not from the passionate, you know, advocate and engaged, addicted blog follower. I have a hard time, in fact, with a lot of the blogs understanding how they get anything else done and who they are in that sense. But many of the blogs you're talking about are political blogs, of course.
Yeah.
They're people like, one of the most celebrated ones is done by a University of Tennessee law professor, for instance. And they're more all the time, as Tom says. They're growing, and not the Barbie doll ones, but the ones about politics.
Right.
They started off, in my sense, mostly from people who were really passionate about something or other, and now I think they're increasingly becoming really passionate about a political perspective that is more of a sort of a calculated thing, perhaps. I don't know. But the point is that the power of blogging is, of course, undeniable. But the audience for blogging tends to be mostly people who are in that world, who are reading each other's things, who are linking to what each other have put out, and the mainstream media journalists who actually are the ones who are taking what this chatter on the blogosphere and turning it into something that becomes news. The thing that has happened is that journalists have started reading blogs, and the mainstream media journalists have started reading blogs, and that is why people like, for instance, Trent Lott. This was in the case of people going after a conservative rather than someone who's perceived to be
liberal. Well, let's explain a bit what you meant by Trent Lott, because that's a blogger story.
Yeah, it's the first big blogger story. Trent Lott is going to a birthday party for Strom Thurmond, his 100th birthday party. It's a social thing. It's Washington. There are plenty of media people there. There are plenty of reporters there. And Trent Lott gets up and says what you say at occasions like this. You know, if they'd listened to you back when you ran for president in 1948, we wouldn't be in all this trouble now. You know, it was kind of a stupid, lame kind of thing to say, and the journalist there blew it off. But there was one ABC journalist there who did not blow it off. He was a young guy. He thought, you know, what is this? He ran as a Dixiecrat in 1948. Mm-hmm. That was a very segregationist platform that Trent Lott seemed to be endorsing, and he's the senior Republican in the Senate. Anyway, the point is, he got it. It went to the ABC blog, The Note, which is a blog
ABC
that a lot of people look at, and the blogosphere picked it up, but the journalists it went right over their heads. Then it started the issue then became, why won't the mainstream media go into this story?
And that was led by conservative bloggers. That's the interesting part of it.
It was certainly conservative bloggers who said, this is a guy we can't afford to have.
That's right.
It was like, you know, but the thing is this, Trent Lott was lost not because of what happened on the blogosphere directly. He lost his position as the, you know, senior man in the Senate for the Republicans, one, because the mainstream media finally picked up the story,
right,
and two, because President Bush said, you know, I never liked him much anyway.
Well, no, I can understand, Tom, the ABC blog. I mean, that was the source of the blogosphere for Trent Lott. I mean, I can understand people going to ABC. It's a brand name. But when we last talked to you on this program, which was just a few minutes ago, you said there are 10 blogs that people go to.
Absolutely.
What are they, for example?
One of them is The Note, ABC's. It's in effect the daybook for the blogosphere.
They do go to ABC?
You bet.
Still?
The second one they go to is Real Clear Politics, which
is not
a right wing or left wing.
No, but I don't understand how Real Clear Politics all of a sudden gets a brand name.
It has, because people who are good in the media read it. I could give you 10 of them. Matter of fact, I think I did give you 10 of them that you ought to read. But here's the interesting thing, and it goes back to Alex's point. The media, mainstream media guys are now reading the blogs, and the reason is they're doing a lousy job.
Because mainstream media is doing lousy.
Both Eastgate and Rathergate were failures of journalism 101. It wasn't the blogosphere that killed them off. It was the failures of the CBS organization to do a good job, and the failure, terrific failure on the part of CNN to do a decent job in the case of
Okay,
Eason
well, let's
Jordan.
Just, before we start dealing with MSM and what's wrong with it, which is fair game, is that's what we're talking about, let's just go back to the two Rathergate and Eason-gate, okay?
Well,
tell us what it is, or you can comment.
Rathergate is the, you know, is the storm that blew up when Dan Rather and CBS News very, very ill-advisedly tried to use a smoking gun in the form of some documents to prove that George Bush did not do what he claimed to do as far as his service.
Right.
And this was something that was spotted as a likely fraud by people who happened to be watching it and who happened to be, you know, wrote something on the web, and it sort of migrated its way through and was seized. Because, you know, in the first place, the people who are watching it seem to know something about documents, and the world out there includes a lot of people that know a lot of very, very, you know, arcane things. That's the great power of the blogosphere, it seems to me, is it harnesses all this incredible knowledge that's simply out there and gives those people, instead of, you know, telling their wife, they go and put it on the web.
It's parallel processing.
But it's also very important to understand that bloggers, for the most part, don't report. They talk.
Yeah.
They don't report.
Yeah.
And if you take the mainstream media out of the equation, the bloggers have very little, usually, to talk about. Rathergate was a response to a mainstream media report. It was a response.
Okay, well, let's talk about Eason-gate. Tom, why don't you just tell us...
Eason-gate was a remarkable thing where the head of news for the most respected and oldest 724 news organization, CNN, was at the World Economic Forum in Davos. He proceeded to deliver a speech in front of a group of highly intelligent and well-connected people, saying that 12 journalists had been killed by U.S. troops and specifically targeted. There was some argument at the occasion, and what ended up happening was dispute ran first in the blogosphere because one of the attendees was asked to post online by the World Economic Forum, and
Where did he post?
He posted in his own blog that was coupled to the World Economic Forum.
But they cleared it.
What happened when you went to the World Economic Forum? I mean, how do you get to that blog? That's the thing.
The blog came from a member of the sitting in the audience who put up a blog.
But how
do you get to it? I'll link you to it. It's easy enough. The interesting issue about this is, wouldn't you think before firing Eason Jordan, CNN would want to see the tape of this?
Yeah, let's go back. Let's talk about what he just said. Eason being fired by CNN without even looking at the tape, and then secondly, whether the blogosphere is a wild west, and did they dethrone Eason unfairly?
Okay, this is my understanding of what happened at Eason-gate. Yeah. First of all, he said something truly stupid. Especially, as you said, Tom, someone in his position, if he goes to a group like that and says something as moronic as that, then he needs to be held to account. And I'm told by people who were there in the room, who I've talked to, that he did say it. And I'm also told by people who seem to know, and I don't know this for sure, that he was the one who did not want the
thing
released.
But you see, we're all working on hearsay.
Okay, well, my point, but the thing is this. The CNN has no, you know, power to force this is not Eason's tape. This is the tape of the World Economic Forum. It was technically off the record. Apparently, they're concerned about precedents that it might set. My guess is that he did not want it released, and basically he got canned or he was invited to resign, and so that was going to be taking care of the problem. But you know, the thing is that what he said. And then what he said, I mean, I don't really know, but what I think he said, what I think he meant, and I can't believe he meant anything else, if he meant that it is now the policy of the American Army to go out and whisper to people to shoot journalists, then he really is off his rocker for saying it without proof, because I don't think there's any proof of it. If he said that the journalists over there are in a situation where there are a lot of scared, tripper, khaki soldiers who are shooting at people, and they're aiming at them, and they don't know they're journalists, but they are aiming at whoever turns out to be a journalist. That's a little different situation.
Well,
that situation at a hotel, for instance, you know, which is the main one. That was, you know, was that mistaken identity, or was that something calculated?
But we don't have to speculate about this, and this is the important part where CNN as an organization fell down. I asked CNN, did you ask Klaus Schwab at the World Economic Forum for a copy of the tape? They said no. We thought what we heard from Eason and various other people was sufficient. I then talked to Klaus Schwab last Friday night. I said, Klaus, if CNN had called you on the phone and said, look, just run a tape of just what Eason said. It's off the record. We don't want anyone else exposed, but we want his remarks. Run a tape for us. Cut it together. Put it together for us. I said, would you do that for them? He said, sure.
But isn't this the Wild West?
I mean, that's a big deal.
Okay. Tom feels like that's a very big deal. I don't feel like it's such a big deal because I think that
you'd
what
fire
he said.
Him on hearsay?
I think you fire him because of what he said and the people there said and what apparently he acknowledged he said because he's gone.
Would you really fire him from that? Doesn't he have a chance?
No, I'd say,
doesn't Eason, he have a chance to backtrack it?
I would say, what did you say, Eason? And he would say, I said this, and you'd say, I'm sorry, we can't have that. Yeah, that's
you've gone for one statement, now you're at Harvard, right? Your boss, the president of Harvard, recently made some very foolish remarks about women, about Jews, about Catholics, all on the record, and he's been attacked by blogs,
right? Let me put it this way. I don't think that this was of an allegation. This was something that he immediately backtracked. At least that's my understanding. Eason Jordan did.
He
immediately said, you misunderstand, this is not what I'm saying.
So why?
So, but I think that the point is, of the tapes is, that is what he said when he started out. And I think he basically concluded that this was going to be, you know, he was going to be hanged anyway, so why, you know, why compound?
Can I take that question on? It's very important, because I think you're underestimating the importance of getting the tape. We're a news organization at CNN. It's our story. Rather said he wanted to report the story if the documents turned out to be fraudulent. Both these new organizations failed the public, the hell with the bloggers, on their basic responsibility. I wouldn't fire Eason Jordan until I'd seen the tape. I would tell him, take a week off. We're getting the tape. We'll take a look at it. We'll
I would say, Eason, what did you say at this thing? Are you making these out? No, I didn't. I said it was stupid. I misspoke. I did this, that. I mean, the point is, CBS was making a concrete allegation and saying, this is the evidence. Eason Jordan shot his mouth off in a public place that he shouldn't have and got canned. It seems to me that those are very different things.
I don't see them different at all because they go to credibility of dying media. And we got two
guys. CNN was not saying this. Eason Jordan was saying it. He got fired for it.
He's the head of CNN. He wasn't fired. He was allowed to resign.
If Dan Rather had gone, you know, to a place and made a racist joke, he would probably have been fired.
But I don't think it's the same equivalent. There are two possibilities with Eason
Jordan. Do we have to see him recording of the joke?
Well, let's take a look at it for a minute. There are two possibilities. Eason Jordan is correct. And he's blowing a story that he owes to his network here at the World Economic Forum. That's possibility number one. Possibility number two is this is a fantasy.
But Tom, you
fire him in both cases.
He's already renounced the impression that he apparently made. He already had addressed what he said and said, that is not what I meant. That is not what I'm saying. I do not believe that. I mean, this was not a CNN allegation. This was Eason Jordan, according to Eason Jordan, now, you know, trying to eat back his words, saying I misspoke.
But I want to ask, in the world of the blogosphere, if somebody misspeaks, president of Harvard, and someone at the World Forum. President Harvard says, I shouldn't have, I take it all back. Easton Jordan seemed to me to try to take some steps. Do you think we're now in a situation everyone gets fired for that sort of thing?
I think that what you're in a situation now, and I think this is absolutely the case, if you do something stupid now, you're not going to get away with it, probably. Because the power of the blogs is it took this incredibly boneheaded thing that Easton Jordan did, and instead of the people in that room saying, what an idiot, it put it, you know, it went on a blog. It went on a blog that probably only a half a dozen people might have seen until it was linked by someone to another blog. It was linked to another, and it spreads virally, and all of a sudden it was out there. And let's not forget, it was in a very polarized political environment, and it was seized upon by people who were, you know, eager to discredit. I mean, Easton Jordan was, it was like, you know, Easton Jordan was apologizing, like Larry Summers. He apologized and he apologized and he apologized. How many times do you have to apologize?
I'm sorry, I don't buy it. Larry Summers is one case. Easton Jordan's a newsman. All right, and if the head of your news broadcast is sky shooting with baloney like that,
you get fired.
You get fired.
Well, that's what happened.
Fine. But they didn't fire him. They let him resign, and they left up in the air what actually happened, and that was the worst sin of all in a news organization.
All right, let's pick up.
The New York Times didn't do that with Jason Blair. They re-reported every story.
This was not a report by CNN. This was not a report by CNN.
The head of their news department.
It was a guy talking in an off-the-record thing. I mean, he said, you misunderstood what I... Oh,
did you see the consequences to the stockholders of Time Warner with the Nielsen ratings yesterday? CNN slipped 21% in prime time last month. It's now one-third the size of Fox News.
I would say that has an awful lot to do with, in part, the sort of, you know, incredible opportunism of the people who hate CNN to try to destroy it and damage it. There's no question about this. This was like Trent Lott was for the liberals. This was like a softball across the plate, and they clobbered it. If they had released the tape, they would have been running the tape forever after. So, okay, so they denied them that pleasure. This is a very nasty environment for competition between CNN and Fox. Fox, I notice, has not been very eager to investigate this sort of, you know, hired pundit stuff. That really hasn't gotten very much of their attention. It's a very polarized environment.
All right.
And that, to me, is a much more important story.
Well, I'm
than
working
this
on
one.
A story on it now.
Good.
I like it.
Good.
I want to pick up on. I want to pick up on what Alex said a few minutes ago. Look, you make one mistake, he says, in the era of blogosphere, and you're down the tubes. Now, I want to ask you how that affects mainstream media. Does that mean we're in a situation now where mainstream media really is at risk? Because if they make any mistake, they're going to get killed.
I don't think you're going to get killed.
Well,
Bill Keller in The New Yorker, the editor of The New York Times, stated that Ailes and Murdoch were exploiting a market opportunity of those disaffected by the mainstream media. Well, if you're losing altitude at the speed of CNN and CBS, this is a business thing. He's right. But, you know, P.J. O'Rourke put it a better way. He said, you know, Roger Ailes found a market niche. He said 75% of the American people, and he put Fox News right in the middle of it. And that's what these ratings show right here. They're three times the ratings
still,
of CNN.
They're still minuscule, Tom, relative
yes,
to...
Yes, they are. You know, with 3 million on the O'Reilly show, while 8 million watch the CBS Evening News.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, let's look at it this way.
All I'm saying is that it's a very politicized environment, and news has become a very politicized environment. And I think that's largely because of the Fox marketing method of denouncing the liberal media, and also basically, turning everything into an issue of left and right. I think that's a great disservice for most, as far as most people are concerned. They want it to be straight. They want it to be told straight.
But it wasn't, Alex. And I think one of the things that's happening, quite honestly, is that the reporting standards we used to all agree upon, that were objective in what we executed, no matter what our feelings might be, have been gone by the board in any number of news organizations. CNN's failure, Easton Jordan sucking up to the audience, the World Economic Forum, Rathergate sucking up his constituent.
Tom, when you watched the Iraq coverage of the Iraq War, did you watch Fox and CNN?
Yeah.
Did you think Fox was better than CNN?
No.
I mean, why?
Because I thought that what Fox was doing was some kind of man in the street type reporting continually, but I never got perspective from the Fox News reporting. CNN kept giving me perspective on what was happening though in the overall engagement, which I appreciate.
Okay, all I'm saying is that, you know, I think that there is plenty of good journalism going on out there. I think that this is an over, you know, I think that there is a despair that people have that they're not getting the story straight. And I think that a lot of journalism's problems are going to be in addressing some, finding some way to reestablish the idea of honest broker journalism. But I don't think Fox is it, and I don't think that that the idea that sort of CNN is being held out is the poster boy of unfair reporting is quite fair.
I don't either, but I think we just saw the worst election reporting in my lifetime in this last election. I've never seen such lazy reporting on both the Bush campaign and the Kerry campaign.
Well, let me just focus this for a moment. Is this what you think is wrong with mainstream media, that the reporting isn't any good, that the whole performance is subpar, and as a consequence, they're losing market share and losing credibility?
Yeah, absolutely. Basically, I think the reporting has gone downhill, and newsrooms have had their budgets cut to the bone by these large owners, this Keiretsu of ownership. They've got no budgets. Foreign correspondents used to exist for networks. They don't anymore. Now it's some Australian working out of ITV in London. So the entire infrastructure that created the wealth of information we depended upon our media from, we had fine newsmen, isn't there anymore.
I completely agree with what Tom just said. I think the real issue here is an economic one that has been fueled by the technological changes. Basically, the news organizations are trying to figure out how to keep their businesses. And what they're doing is doing anything they can to attract anybody. And that has made it much, much more sort of like pandering, especially on television.
Everything's features.
And as Tom says, they're cutting their costs as much as they possibly can because they're protecting the profit margins. And where that was the number one cost after, you know, paper for a newspaper is people. And these expensive, high quality, highly trained reporters are going by the board, and this and the news budgets are getting, you know, squeezed and squeezed, and the budgets that are there, the money is being spent on things that have much more of a direct relationship to advertising and to public relations. I think one of the most sinister things are these video news releases that are now being released and are being
used. Tell me what they are.
Video news releases are made to look like segments of a local television show, and they are theoretically just a video version of the kind of press release that you would send out by, you know, on paper. But in fact, what they are is a very inviting way for local television to save money by simply dropping this into their report as though and looking very much like it is a piece of journalism, when in fact it's a piece of promotion. You know, for the last 20 years, they've been, you know, increasingly used by pharmaceutical companies and things like that to sort of like, you know, doctors have found a new cure for cancer. They put, we'll be right back. And then they'll put this thing with a doctor with a stethoscope around his neck that nobody's ever heard of.
And now the Defense Department is doing it.
And
I
now
mean,
they're
the government's
doing it for
now
politics.
Getting into the same
all right,
game.
So
and the thing is, the stations do it because it's cheap. That's why. Because they don't have to spend the money to put something.
All right, now, Alex Jones, you're at Shorenstein Center. You've written a great book on the New York Times. You're a well-known media expert, generally speaking. What do you think is going to happen to mainstream media?
I think, frankly, the best thing that will happen to mainstream media is the blogosphere. Because, one, the blogosphere is holding them accountable. It's like you were saying, Tom. You can't, it's not that you're killed, but it's like you've got to have your stuff together. You're going to get criticized. You're not going to get sort of, you're not going to get by with it. You're going to have people like Tom Lipscomb calling you lazy for the kind of campaign reporting you're doing. And that, you know, the thing is, you're operating now in an environment in which people are able to give you, you know, feedback, correct errors, demand things, denounce you, whatever, in a way that is instantaneous almost and very widespread. That's number one. But number two, I think what you're going to see is that journalists are going to start blogging themselves. And what that's going to do is bring this sort of reservoir of additional knowledge that's out there, like these people who...
Well, let me tell you, can you explain to me what you mean?
Yeah.
You say a journalist is going to blog himself.
Sure. Some do already.
So a blog does is it basically puts you in touch with people. It allows them to be in touch with you,
right,
hypothetically, because you post and they post back. Not everybody does that, but most people do. And the idea is you start a conversation and make yourself available to people who maybe, you know, who, I mean, it's like people who call you on the phone and give you tips. But someone is out there who says, you know, those documents on CBS, they're phony. They're no good. That's the kind of, and I'm speaking as someone who is the document expert for 25 years and have done ba-dum, 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 and this is why. I mean, the point is, it makes that connection much faster, and journalists, I think, can, I hope, win back some of that credibility that you were talking
sure.
about, you know, fairly, by being in the blog within the journalistic tradition, more informal, more direct, and seeming to have more of a kind of a connection with people that a lot of people, as young people especially, find appealing. That's one of the things about the blogosphere that young people are attracted to. It looks like people are really speaking their minds. Now, that's also very...
Fire with fire.
Well, but the thing is, journalists cannot abandon journalistic traditions and values and standards. The blogosphere is a different creature in other ways. The bloggers, for the most part, not all of them.
The bloggers don't have credibility.
They don't want to be. They don't want to be journalists. They don't want to be reporters. They are commentators. They're observers. They're kibitzers. They're people who are pointing out hypocrisies and errors and stupidities. That's what they like to do. But they base that on reporting that somebody has to
right.
do, and somebody's got to pay for it.
That's right. And let me come to that point, because Alex has brought up a very important point. Somebody's got to pay for it. I think the CNN drop in ratings, I think the fall off in revenues to advertising and newspapers, the New York Times is in trouble, the Wall Street Journal is in trouble, according to their forecast for the future, will come back if we go back to news reporting. Remember, in the Daily Paper in 1965, something like 60% of Americans between 21 and 50 read one daily. Okay, today it's less than 34%.
People aren't going to come back and read newspapers
read
the way they did before the internet and before
really?
Cable television.
Really? Somehow the Post has gone from 400,000 lousy circulation to
750,000.
Well, it depends on what you call a newspaper. You can have lively journalism, you can break news, but this kind of lazy sleepwalking has got to stop.
Let's go back to your point about journalists becoming bloggers themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that will make newspapers, say, or TV stations more powerful, have more circulation, larger broadcasts? We reached a point where there ain't going to be no more growth in those areas.
I think that, first of all, we're heading into a very unknown territory. I don't think
that's why we're doing the program.
I mean, I think that we don't know what the new model, economic model is. I'm told that there are now is more readers, more eyeballs on the New York Times website than there are for the paper itself.
I'm sure that's so.
But the money is still in the advertising that appears in the paper itself. The advertising that appears on the web would not support the New York Times news staff
right.
for a month. So there's got to be, if you're going to have a New York Times, you're going to have some kind of economic model that will allow
that
to happen.
We don't know what it is.
Happen.
And we've also come to the end of the program, so I'm going to ask you. Will MSM, that's mainstream media, that's New York Times, will it survive the bloggers?
Yes or no, Alex? Yes, as long as books survive.
What the hell kind of answer is that? Thank you all for coming by, Alex.
Yes.
All right, now, Tom, you have the same question.
Listen,
and you got 1 second to
yes,
answer.
Yes, the newspaper, mainstream media will survive as long as it's honest, interesting, and I have to read it.
Geez, I don't know if you guys give me much of an answer. Well, thanks for coming by, Tom.
Pleasure.
Thanks for coming by, Alex.
Sure.
And thank you for coming by. And come back next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.